Welcome to the Medics Guide. My name is Saleha and today I'll be teaching you about chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. So grab your pen and paper and let's get started. COPD is defined as a long-term progressive airflow obstruction with little to no reversibility. This is different from asthma, which is defined as a reversible airflow obstruction. COPD encompasses both emphysema and chronic bronchitis. Emphysema is a condition in which there's abnormal air in the tissues after the terminal bronchioles. This causes destruction of the alveoli and they can join together to form bullae, which can rupture and cause a pneumothorax. There's a significant association between heavy cigarette smoking and emphysema. Chronic bronchitis is defined as an airway obstruction with a productive cough, and that's for most days of about 3 months for 2 years. It involves inflammation and goblet cell hyperplasia. Similarly, there's a significant link between chronic bronchitis and smoking. So there's a range of causes of COPD. Firstly, there's alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. That's a genetic cause, and I'll discuss it in more detail in just a bit. As we said, smoking is one of the biggest risk factors for developing COPD, and that's because of the chronic inflammatory effects of the particles, chemicals, reactive oxygen species. Similarly, things like pollutants, dust, chemicals, and fumes increase the risk. So in your social history, you really want to be asking about occupation, where they live, is it close to a motorway, any hazards, working in factories, indoor biomass fuel burning, and also low socioeconomic status is a risk factor as well. So coming back to alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, it's a protein that's produced in the liver. It's then secreted into the blood and it diffuses into the lungs. And it's an inhibitor of proteinases, specifically in the context of COPD, something called neutrophil elastase. Elastases would normally destroy alveolar wall connective tissue, so alpha-1 antitrypsin prevents it from doing that. What happens in the inflammatory process is that neutrophils, they collect together in the alveolar capillaries and they release elastase. As there's no alpha-1 antitrypsin to inhibit the elastase, there's unchecked alveolar destruction. To summarise, chronic inflammation is central to the pathophysiology of COPD. Repeat injury and repair results in structural changes in the lung, which increase with disease severity and persist even after smoking cessation. These include airway remodelling, increased goblet cells, vascular bed changes, and loss of alveoli. Breakdown of elastin causes a decreased elastic recoil, fibrotic changes in the parenchyma, and luminal obstruction by secretions. This all results in increased airway resistance. Cor pulmonale is a condition that results from this hypoxia that we just discussed. So I've drawn a diagram here to help demonstrate it. We start off with a normal heart. Blood from the body enters the right side of the heart via the vena cava and leaves to the lungs via the pulmonary artery. Hypoxia and acidosis causes vasoconstriction and loss of pulmonary vascular tissue. This means there's an increase in vascular resistance, causing high pressure in the vein. As a result, there can be a backflow of blood into the right ventricle. When you have persistent hypertension, the heart grows more muscle to help overcome the vascular resistance from the backflow of blood. This is called right ventricle hypertrophy. Over time, the right ventricle function gets progressively more compromised, and you can develop right-sided heart failure. We will see signs of this, such as peripheral edema, due to blood flowing back through the vena cava and pooling in the limbs. Eventually, this can ultimately lead to a congestive heart failure, where the left ventricle is also compromised. There are many signs and symptoms that can be seen in COPD patients. The three key ones are a chronic cough, sputum production, and dyspnea. This may be accompanied by a wheeze or chest tightness. I've summarised the key signs and symptoms as you would see them if you were examining a patient OSCE styles. So to begin with, looking from the bedside, you want to be assessing if they're short of breath or coughing, and the severity of this. Are they breathless at rest? Can they complete full sentences? Is there a vomit bowl nearby that you could look at their sputum in? A patient might also be in a characteristic tripod position, like this guy here, where they're using all the accessory muscles to help them breathe. You can see he also has pursed lips and looks quite cachectic. Moving on to the hands, you may see tar staining from smoking and a flapping tremor which indicates CO2 retention. In the neck, one of your key signs is a raised JVP, which indicates cor pulmonale. In this video here, you can see this patient has a tracheal tug, where the trachea moves up and down with each breath. You can also see clear use of accessory muscles. Moving on to the chest, you want to first inspect. Some of the signs are hyperinflation, which is described as a barrel chest. You can see it in this patient here. This occurs due to an increase in lung compliance and an increase in end expiratory volume because of the loss of elastic recoil. You may also note paradoxical breathing or intercostal drawing. When palpating, you may feel a parasternal heave due to right ventricle hypertrophy, and there may be a hyperresident percussion due to areas of emphysema and bulle. On auscultation, you may hear reduced breath sounds or a polyphonic wheeze. You may also hear crackles due to the opening and closing of collapsed airways. Lastly, make sure to check the sacrum and legs for edema, a sign of right-sided heart failure. A mnemonic to help you remember some of these key signs is smoker. S for short of breath. M for muscles, as in using their accessory muscles. O for edema, which is a sign of right-sided heart failure. K for cachexic, but if you spell it with a K instead. E is for emphysematous bulle, which can result in hyperresident percussion and reduced breath sounds. And lastly, R for a raised JVP. In terms of investigations, ABGs are really important to determine if a patient is in respiratory failure due to hypoxia or hypercapnia. A chest x-ray is also important to rule out a lot of differentials. Some of the key signs you'll see in a patient with COPD, like in this picture here, are hyperinflated lungs with a flat hemidiaphragm. You'll see reduced peripheral lung markings, emphysematous bulle, signs of right ventricle hypertrophy, and you might see large pulmonary arteries as well. Similarly, an ECG can show signs of right-sided hypertrophy, which could be right axis deviation, peaked P waves, and sinus tachycardia. The most important investigation in terms of diagnosis is, however, spirometry. In particular, you're going to be looking for a post-bronchodilator FEV1 FVC of less than 70% predicted. This demonstrates airflow obstruction. FEV1 is also used, and it can be to assess the severity of COPD. You might also want to culture any sputum and check antitrypsin levels if that's indicated. So as I mentioned, you can assess severity of COPD, and there are a lot of different scales, one of which is the GOLD grading, which can be 1 to 4, mild to very severe, and that uses FEV1 predicted percentage. The MMRC dyspnea scale is used to assess breathlessness on a scale of 0 to 4 based on the patient's perception of their symptoms. And then you can have the Bode index, and that uses a combination of multiple factors, and it adds up a score which can be used to assess the 4-year survival. Okay, so moving on to management. Management of a COPD patient relies really heavily on their symptoms. So if they're chronic but stable, you can start them off on a SABA, a short-acting beta-2 agonist such as salbutamol, or a SAMA such as ipratropium. Then if they still are breathless or if they have exacerbations, you have to determine if they have asthmatic features. So you can do this by seeing if they have any previous secure diagnosis of asthma or atopy, if they have a high blood eosinophil count, if they have significant variation in their FEV1 over time, or if they have a significant diuretal variation in their peak expiratory flow. So if they don't have asthmatic features, you can add a LABA, such as salmeterol, and a LAMA, such as tiptropium. And then if they're on a SAMA, you want to switch them over to a SABA. If they do have those asthmatic features, you can start them on a LABA and inhaled corticosteroid combination, such as seretide. And then they can be on a SABA or a SAMA alongside that. If they're still breathless and they still have exacerbations, you can just put them all together. You can put them on a LABA with an inhaled corticosteroid and a LAMA as well. So additionally, some COPD patients can benefit from long-term O2 therapy, which improves survival rates. So you're going to aim for more than 15 hours per day, and you want the PaO2 to be greater than 8. If they're still breathless, you can consider adding theophylline, a phosphodiesterase inhibitor, and you can refer them for pulmonary rehab. You can also add a steroid such as prednisolone to help with the inflammation. You can also consider prophylactic oral antibiotics such as azithromycin to prevent an infective exacerbation. Ultimately, COPD patients will benefit from surgery such as lung volume reduction or even a lung transplant. When talking to literally any smoking patient, the most important thing to push is for smoking cessation, as it's the only intervention proven to decelerate the decline in FEV1 in our COPD patients. And there's lots of replacements available for nicotine. There's NDRIs, nicotine receptor blockers. In terms of symptomatic relief, you can offer mucolytics, antidepressants, diuretics. COPD patients are also eligible for an annual flu vaccine and a one-off pneumococcal vaccine. Physiotherapy can also help with the excess mucus secretion. All right, let's see what we've learned with a question. So the question is, a 55-year-old man attends his GP with a history of increasing shortness of breath upon exertion. He was diagnosed with COPD several months previously and started on a salbutamol inhaler on an as-required basis. So that's your SABA. His past medical history includes childhood asthma, which he reports required several hospitalizations. Which of the following would be the most appropriate next steps in the management of this man's COPD? So we have a couple of options here. You can pause the video now and have a go. Okay, so we have LABA, LAMA only, LABA and LAMA, LABA and ICS, LAMA and ICS. Okay, so do you remember the flowchart of the treatment of patients that are still breathless despite using a SABA or SAMA? We have to check if they have asthmatic features. Now we know our patient here already has asthma, so the next step is to give him a LABA combined with an ICS. So the correct option is D. If they weren't asthmatic, we'd give them a LABA and a LAMA. Have a look at the flowchart again to remind yourself if you are confused about this. All right, that's all for today. COPD is a really long topic and honestly, I find it really hard. So well done for staying all the way to the end. Please remember to give us a like if you found this useful and don't forget to subscribe. Let us know what videos you'd like to see from the Medics Guide. Bye.